Welcome back. The AI reference kits from Intel in collaboration with Accenture. There are many of them, they are free and open source, and they could be your first step to an AI-based product. In these short videos, we'll talk about the visual quality control inspections for Life Science Toolkit. In short, the visual inspection reference kit. This is an end-to-end example of performing quality control of a product line. And I will leave you all the links and the instructions below. The goal is to identify defected pills. You can see here examples of good pills and of defected ones. Having humans visually inspect each pill is expensive. Think about a 24/7 product line with millions of pills to sort at a rate of 2 pills per second, for example. People need breaks. People make mistakes, and maybe this assembly line does not have good working conditions. Not safe, too hot, air is polluted. The machines do not care. So it makes a lot of sense to automate the process, and this is exactly what this reference kit is doing. Once you build an application that can do that and detect the defected pills, it should be easy to integrate it into a working product line. The example shows the implementation of an AI-based detection of defects in pills, but you can easily try other types of products and objects. Bolts, capsulates, screws, and other objects should work as well. Pay attention that the dataset linked to the toolkit is not free for commercial use. So in this video, I'll overview the full process in high level. In the next video, we'll actually run the flow end to end. And in the last video, I'll talk about using your own data to your own specific product line, adjusting the flows and so on. So it all starts with the data. You can easily detect that this pill is good and this one has a defect, but how can a computer detect it? For you, all of these pills are the same. Humans can still detect the pills if they are rotated, scaled, shifted, or of a little different color. For a computer, if you change one pixel, it's a totally different image. What we need is a system that is invariant to these image manipulations, like rotation, shifting, and so on. And this is exactly what our deep learning model is doing. It sounds like magic, so let me explain it in a minute. The deep learning-based model we're using, in this case, is a variation of VGG16. It is a convolutional neural network. Most of the first layers are convolutions. It has 16 layers, and it was originally trained using a dataset called ImageNet that has more than 14 million training images across 1,000 object classes. Each of the first layers is using mathematical operations to basically extract features of the image. Features in an image are, for example, lines, corners, the specific regions in the image that helps us human too to understand what's in that image. The deeper you go into the neural network, you're getting finer grain feature. And at the end, we can use a feature map to make decisions. For example, if feature 4 from the first layer and feature 8 from the third layer exist, it might be a round object with a defect, for example. Let's look at the model we're using. On the left side, you can see the original VGG16. If we zoom in, you can see that the first layers are convolution and another convolution. And after a few such layers, we have a large set of features that we can extract from each image. And we can use a feature map to make decisions down here. On the right hand, the first layers of our model are also convolutions, the same convolutions, but the final processing the classification had is replaced to meet our specific needs in this case, classifying good or bad pills. If you'd like more details, you can read more in this article. Looking visually at the layers of the neural network, we can draw like heat maps of the filters of the layers. What's nice about that is that It is not only performing classification, good or bad, but can also show you the location of the defect if found. You can see here, for example, one pill I chose and how the feature map looks like after the second layer. You can clearly see that it understands that the object is oval. The next layer is more specific features. You can see the curves. Next layer, smaller features. I can see here even points. And in the next layer, you can see even smaller specific features. And here, even smaller. So let's try to get some intuition by looking at a good pill below and a one with defect on the top. Look at the red arrows, and you can see below that we're expecting a black image, but since we are getting a white dot, a high value for the top pill, not only that we know that it has a defect, but we can even understand its location. And same goes for this defect. Expected below dark heat map, a high value, a white dot instead for the top pill with the location for the defect. Nice. So I'd like to take a minute to overview the full story, the full pipeline as brought in the reference kit. I'll explain step by step and actually run it in the next video. First step is to arrange the data. We divide it to training data and test data, and ideally we have for each one of them good pills and bad pills placed in corresponding directories. We do not label or mark the regions of the defects. It will be done automatically. Once the data is in place, we can train the model. As said, the model is based on VGC16. We're not training the full model. We are freezing most of it. All the feature extraction layers, the first layers, can be used as is with their original weights, so no need to retrain them. We will only train the head, the last layers. Since we're not training the full network, this means that the training process can be executed on a simple CPU in a reasonable time, which is a great advantage. We will take all the images in the training directory, pass them through the model, and adjust the weights. The result of this stage is a trained model that could classify the good pills from the bad ones. This training is done using the PyTorch framework. Intel is helping to improve PyTorch, but also has an extension for PyTorch, what we call IPEX. Basically enhancements to the stock PyTorch. Please see my other video on Intel extensions for PyTorch IPEX. We will rerun the training and later the inference using IPEX, and you could see for yourself the performance boost it can give you over PyTorch using the same code. For me, on my i9 CPU, IPEX was almost twice as faster as PyTorch. Once we have a model we would like to evaluate it, we have used the training dataset for the training, and now we will try to classify the test dataset, basically images that were never introduced to the model. We will check the accuracy, meaning the percentage of correct classifications, and we will measure the performance, how fast it can do it. Everything we did so far, the training and the inference, were done on a model which all the operations are done using floating point numbers, FP32, so 32 bit long. It allows for good accuracy and a wide dynamic range of numbers. But this level of accuracy is sometimes not needed during the inference phases. Once the model is converged, many times the weights do not need to be represented using floating point or 32 bits. And converting them to integers, int8 for example, will not degrade the accuracy much. The performance, however, could be dramatically improved. First, we'll need only 8 versus 32 bits, so much smaller weights, but also faster execution time and more. During this phase, we'll quantize the model using INC, Intel Neural Compressor, from FP32 to INT8, and we'll compare the results, the accuracy, and the inference performance. At that stage, you have a working model, and you can take the PyTorch code to an application and a product But there are several advantages to run the inference using OpenVINO. OpenVINO is the deployment toolkit by Intel. I'll show you how easy it is to take the model, benchmark it, and run it, not only on a CPU, but also on a GPU and many other devices, and with better performance, lower memory consumptions, and more. And this is all for now. On the next video, we'll run the reference kit step by step. And in the video after, we'll talk about customization and advanced stuff. See you there.